In the summer of 1981, U2 was torn between the music that had given their lives meaning and the Christianity that had given them peace. It did not seem that the two could coexist, and the tension threatened to break up the band. Adam Clayton, who was not born again, saw his three friends slipping away and taking U2 with them. Larry was the first to decide that the born-again Christians were asking for too much. Bono followed. Edge hesitated. Bono and he went for a walk. Edge expected Bono to lobby on behalf of the band. He didn't. Bono told Edge to follow his heart. Edge decided to stick with U2.
We went through a couple of, I think it was about a month, where really we had to do a lot of soul searching, and in the end, we were pretty unanimous in the way we felt that, you know, this, there was no problem. It was just other people's problems. And we just carried on.
On August 21st, 1982, Bono married his high school sweetheart, Allison Stewart. Bono asked Adam to be the best man. It was a gesture of renewed loyalty after their born-again period. U2's touring in America had built a strong following. The new cable channel MTV was playing their videos. They needed to make an album that would deliver on their promise. War presented a focused, grown-up U2. The group had found their voice. Under a blood-red sky, a crowd has gathered, black and white. Bono's stage act grew more elaborate and more dangerous as U2's audiences got bigger. He was trying to connect with the crowds in the same way that he had in the small clubs. He began a ritual of taking a white flag from the stage out into the crowd and climbing the scaffolding, balconies, and speaker columns. The audiences got crazier too. At one show, Bono climbed up the balcony and was mobbed with fans. In an effort to escape, he jumped 20 feet to the crowd below. By the time he reached the stage again, Bono's clothes were ripped to shreds and his flagpole was split in half. U2 played to their biggest crowd yet as part of the 3-day US Festival in California. With 125,000 people in the audience, Bono had to work hard to get everyone's attention. He did it, but he nearly killed himself in the process.
It had got pretty scary on some of the shows. So yeah, there'd been a policy of, you know, don't leave the stage without written permission from all three of us.
While on tour in America, U2 saw an exhibition at the Chicago Peace Museum called The Unforgettable Fire. The exhibit was a collection of paintings and drawings by the survivors of the bombings in Nagasaki and Hiroshima. The Peace Museum also had a collection of work dedicated to Martin Luther King Jr. It was with these images in mind that the band went home to Dublin to make their next album.
I guess after the war tour and the subsequent step that Under a Blood Red Sky achieved for us, I think we as a band realized that we really had to kind of pull it together as the band to go the next stage. It was either an end of something or it was a beginning of something else. And The Unforgettable Fire was what that new beginning was.
On July 13th, 1985, U2 played to the world at Live Aid. They were an up-and-coming band compared to the music heavyweights that were performing that day. But they took the stage at Wembley and stole the show.
I think there was generally a feeling that, you know, we'd done something very uncool in England, which was the capital of cool, by actually showing some emotion on the day and actually taking the event seriously for what it was.
The thing that I'm most proud of being a part of is Live Aid. Being there and actually seeing music not just make a difference in people's lives, but actually save lives, was something I'd always felt, but I'll never really recover from.
U2 had arrived. Rolling Stone magazine hailed the group as the band of the 80s. In 1986, U2 headlined Amnesty International's Conspiracy of Hope tour. The last show at Giant Stadium was broadcast on MTV and featured an all-star cast, including a reunion of the Police, for their last performance together. At the end of the Police's set, they handed their instruments to U2. It was a symbolic passing of the torch to the new biggest band in the world. U2 had finally achieved their goal. They were now a stadium band, rock superstars, and cultural spokesmen. They had no idea what they were in for. Yeah.